Good morning. Good morning.
Thank you. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
We'd like to get out of the room started with scripture.
Amen. Amen.
I'll be reading Psalm 62. Verses 1 through 8.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Truly my soul wait upon God, and can come in my salvation. He only is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense. I shall not be greatly moved. How long will ye imagine mischief against the man? Ye shall be slain, all of you, as a bull wall shall ye be, and as a totally pigs. They only consort to cast him down from his excellency. They delight in lies, they bless with their mouth, but they curse the sword. Say, my soul, wait God, only upon God, for my expectation is from him. He only is my rock and my salvation.
Amen.
My life, I shall not be moved. And God is my salvation.
Yes.
My glory.
Yeah.
Strength,
yes.
Jesus in God. Trust in him at all times.
I don't know what God has done in your life. But the Bible just reminded us of get things paid off and then they break. Oftentimes, not enough money for a month. And you're working hard and you wonder why you have all these shortcomings and down all in your life. I just want to be real with you. Every now and then I complain. Why does God let good things, bad things happen to good folks? I complain, but even when I complain, God declares that He blesses the things of God. And that's the reason I'm praying. God is worthy of all I pray. Folks dying and losing their lives daily. But God said, I know the moment for us. We ought to be able to turn it back.
Better, 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 better County visitors here today with us?
To all the faces that I don't recognize, we want to say thank you for coming. We recognize this past many churches along the way. We are thankful unto God that He gave you the spirit to worship with us. And we know that our worship experience will be that much better because of your presence. Again, you are welcome. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. At this time, my own sister Jordan will come with our announcements.
Celebrating our church's anniversary on the second Sunday in December. It's not our day, it's Emmanuel's day. And we want to have a great time in the Lord. As she just stated, all of you, I think you know Miss LOL. She's a great comedian around the city of Chattanooga. And we're just asking you to come out and support. There's no donation, there's no charge, but we are accepting donations. It's Emmanuel's Day, and I would hate for us to have a lot of guests in the house, and then we don't show up. We're asking every member for $100. Organizations, do your best. We're aiming for $1,000, but if you can't, do your best.
Show up and show out, because God is going to be in the house, and He already don't show up, because He's already going to take. So we want you to come support, because it's New Emmanuel's church at first, and we're going to take what you're going to go back. We know there's over 100, so we are blessed to still be here. We are continuing to be a light in the community.
But we don't think little becomes much more certain. needs. And we have to ask. We must be obedient. God tells us that we have to be obedient.
That's right.
John 2:5-6 reads, but if anyone obeys his word, love for God is truly made complete in them. This is how we know we are in him. Whoever claims to live in him must live as Jesus did. We got to obey. That goes for teachers, parents, Sunday school teachers. We have to obey. That's just part of life. We have to obey. And if we don't want to get caught up, we're going to need to obey. Amen.
Amen.
And just know that I got some fun sea creatures out front for y'all and some crazy daddies. Yay. So let us all get for a word of prayer. Most gracious and heavenly Father, we thank you for obedience. We thank you that you are with us forever and always, continuing to guide us through our trials and tribulations. Let us not be easily influenced by others around us and continue to do your word. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
God. Thank you. These things. Let no one despise your youth. Instead, you should be an example to the believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity. Until I come, give your attention to public reading, exhortation, and teachings. Do not neglect the gift that is in you. It was given to you through prophecy with the laying on of hands by the council of elders. Practice these things. Be committed to them. so that your progress may be evident to all. Pay close attention to your life and your teaching. Persevere in them. For by doing this, you will save both yourself and your hearers. Just for a few moments, with the aid of the Holy Spirit, I'd like to talk about being an example. This morning, my brothers and sisters, that we have assembled on another Lord's Day. Young people, I have often heard one's life and its worth is determined by the examples it leaves behind. And whether our examples are good or bad, we will all be judged by them. People will judge how we conduct ourselves and what inspires our desires, aspirations, and dreams. The Cambridge Dictionary offers several definitions, and one such definition is something that is typical of a group of things that is, it is a number of. Another one is a person or way of behaving that is considered suitable to be copied. And for the purposes and all intent of this sermon, this is where we want to focus our attention on a person or a way of behaving that is considered suitable to be copied. And I don't know about you, my brothers and sisters, but when I was out there, I wanted to be the attention. I wanted to be the center of attraction. I wanted to leave my mark by letting everybody know Caleb or Cody that T. Hannah was in the house. Ain't no party like a party that T. Hannah was at. But Buddy Shalama, I was terrible out there when I was out there in the streets, but I wanted everybody to see me, to recognize me, and to know that I had been where everybody else was, because I wanted to leave my mark as an example of how you are a part. Oh, I thought somebody was going to pray with me this morning. Some of y'all act like y'all been saved all y'all life. Ain't never been to the glory, right? Ain't never. What was that y'all used to go on King Street? What's the name of the club? The whole note, we act like we ain't never been in the whole note, but we have to understand that it was not until we understood that folk were imitating us. Acting, behaving the same way we were. The things I could do and the places I could go had no effect on me. Minister Raymond, so it seemed, but it wasn't, it would cause a problem for others. Some of us can go to the club after being saved and not have a drink. But some of us, if we go to the club, it presupposes we gotta have a drink. And there ain't nothing wrong with having a drink, because God's word don't say you can't drink. But it does say don't become a drunkard. In other words, you do it, don't let it do you. That's all truth right there. But we gotta be examples in everything we do. God didn't call us to sit on the sideline with our lights concealed. And that's where we are. The text, Paul is writing to his young protege in the ministry, and sometimes as we are parents,
The hardest thing to do is to allow our children to grow up and to make their way into the world. And I do believe that this aligns with Apostle Paul's thought process while penning this letter to young Timothy. Paul affectionately calls Timothy a true son in chapter 1, verse 2, charging Timothy repeatedly to remain faithful to what Paul had already taught him. And you must understand that Timothy was a native of Lystra. He was in Macedonia at a church of Ephesus. He was not familiar there. And Paul had left him there to do ministry and to carry on at the church. And while there, Paul felt it necessary to encourage young Timothy. You know, you have to understand, there was something special about Timothy as a boy. Paul understood it. Paul tells him over in 2 Timothy to stir up the gift that is already in you, that was given to you from your mama and your grandma. And this suggests that Paul's encounter with Eunice and Lois on his first missionary journey is when Paul, young Timothy, had the opportunity to confess his faith in Christ. And Paul was so impressed by young Timothy. And it is said that Paul took Timothy with him and Silas on the second missionary journey. He was the liaison between a few churches. In other words, when Paul had to leave and they needed to hear the word of God, they needed to continue to be taught, Paul would leave young Timothy as him and Silas would go and continue the work of evangelizing the world for God. And yet Paul continuously warns Timothy about danger, the danger of wandering off course and into intriguing, pointless arguments of theological conscience. In other words, that an opinion or conclusion formed based on incomplete information. Paul is warning Timothy, let me tell you what's going on. There were some false teachers who were trying to pervert the word of God, and Paul wants Timothy to know that he's got to be strong. Young people, I stopped to tell you today, it ain't always easy in the Church of Jesus Christ. Something about the church that we always want to hold our young people back and have them to wait till they're at least 50 years old before they can do anything in the church. But young people, I stop by to tell you, be an example. This is what I need you to understand. Paul is warning Timothy about getting caught up in all of these intriguing and pointless arguments, this theological conjuring, because new information sometimes seems harmless, confined to philosophical jostling and talk, but deviation from the orthodoxy, the authorized or generally accepted doctrines and practices of Christianity proves not only powerful, but diabolical. All it takes, young people and senior saints alike, is for us to start entertaining some fake news. For example, if we lived in that time where President Trump said that all the immigrant people were eating the cats, we would have bought our cats inside. But because of unfounded information, untrue sources, that lie spread like wildfire. And what Paul is saying is you ought to be careful what you take in, because what you take in is what shows up. So he says, you got to be careful. Paul instructs Timothy to command and teach these things But in teaching about Christ, Paul says, here it is, let no one despise your youth. Instead, you should be an example to the believers. And perhaps I don't know why Paul wrote these words. I want to suggest that maybe there was some that was at the church of Ephesus that did not like the fact that Paul had so much confidence in Timothy to leave him in charge, that they were jealous, that they had a problem. They resented him for being over them. Others simply looked down their nose at this pretentious young person, much as the Goliath despised young David. And in its perennial problem, older people have always found the challenge to accept young people as responsible adults. We want to dismiss them as childish, irrelevant, immature, concerned only about themselves. But I stop by to tell you that that is not the way young people are. Young people are discovering, exploring, and trying to figure out who they are and what we do as a church.
We don't mind. I ain't got a hat on. Amen.
But what we do in the church is we stop the growth because we want to quote Paul when Paul said, when I was a child, I felt like a child. I spake like a child. But when I became a man, I put childish things away. And in putting our childish things away, we lose our creativity to worship God.
Oh, I thought somebody was going to pray for me. Okay.
Because when we lose our creativity, we have a prescribed way and a formula by which we are to approach God. But I stop by to tell you that God has not given us any direction other than to worship Him in spirit and in truth. And you ain't got to be old to worship God in spirit and in truth.
You got your way. I promise I'm almost ready.
But young people are understandably irritated when their elders keep reminding them of their immaturity and inexperiences and treat them with contempt. And how do you think children or young people are going to respond when we're always holding up before them the mistakes that they make? And I had to think about this. But there we act like we ain't never made any mistakes. We act like we never gave our parents any problems. Young people, if you still have your grandparents around, start counting gray hairs in your grandparents' head. Those gray hairs are a sign that your mama, your hands, and your uncle got on your mama's nerves. And if they can get on their mama's nerves, you can get on your mama's nerves. But we want our young people to be seen and not heard, and we wonder why our young people are not coming. Young Christian leaders react in this situation so that their youth is not despised or their ministry is not rejected.
We all know how to roll our eyes, shake our head to the side, snap our fingers.
But how are we as future Christian leaders to respond to all of the ill treatment that comes our way from those who are supposed to be showing us the way instead of blocking our way? to keep our young people and youth engaged in church. They cannot respond by boastful assertions or aggressive behavior. That is not the model that Christ espouses. What he wants us to do is to be meek and turn the other cheek. What Christ wants us to do is to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. We're not to try to achieve who we are, being an example by throwing our way around about and trying to impose our will. But it's through a different approach all together. And so Paul says, don't let people look down on you because you are young. See that they look up to you because you are an example. And that was the good news of the text for me, that Paul reminds us that we should not allow people to look down on us. But he tells us that we ought to be an example. Well, unless I hold you too long, there are a few things I want to lift up about being an example. The first thing about being an example means that if you want to be an example, you have to be an example by watching your example. Speech and life encompass the observable aspects of life. It is how we conduct ourselves. Speech is a valid indicator of a person's character, for out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. And the principle is to pursue Christ so diligently that our inner spirit is purified, producing only good and appropriate things to say. The same is true about our outward acts and our lifestyle. Faith and love are the essence of the Christian life. Faith is our knowledge and confidence in Christ, our deepest reliance on what he has done and what he declared as truth. And love is the Holy Spirit's action in our lives, the evidence of our relationship with God who rules and reigns. Purity refers to our sexual conduct and integrity of heart. And you know that it seems sexually inappropriate and a mysterious picture, our relationship to God. But God is very particular about how we treat our bodies and the home and honor of us. Sexual power of purity is a symbol of spiritual consecration. Misconduct in this area of life ruins fellowship with Christ and destroys a person's influence and reputation with others. Authentic Christianity or spirituality can be separated from the righteousness inner life of Christians. Christianity, which is an honest and genuine envelope, the entire person, the inner heart and spirit, to the outer behavior. In other words, Paul is trying to tell them that we are to be an example by watching our example. You gotta watch the way you talk. You got to watch the way you act. You got to watch the way you live out your faith in front of folk, because somebody is watching how you are acting. You gotta act like a Christian on your job. You gotta act like a Christian in the classroom. You gotta act like a Christian in your playtime. You gotta act like a Christian when ain't nobody looking. Because somebody is always trying to see if you are walking the walk, and the way you are an example is by watching the example you give up. For watching us, we think because we can slip in and slip out that they don't want to see us. We think because we changed our hairstyle or pulled the ball cap down and put on some glasses and a face mask that then nobody recognize. But I stop by to tell you that you got to be an example by the example you need, because somebody may not be able to see your face. They may not recognize your hairstyle. They may not hear your voice, honey, but as soon as they see you walk, honey, baby, they know who you are. Cause don't nobody walk like you, ain't nobody acting like you. You better be an example by watching your example. Be an example by being committed. It's right there in the text. I didn't make it up. It says in verse 13, he says, until I come, give your attention to public reading, exhortation, and teaching. Do not neglect the gift that is in you. It was given to you through prophecy with the laying on of hands by the council of elders. Practice these things, be committed, there it is, to them, so that your progress may be evident to all. Not only must we be an example by watching our example, but we must be an example by being committed. Paul says, until I come, there are a few things you ought to do. He talks about public reading and the example of the written Bible, we must admit, is a difficult book. Therefore, it must be explained. The Christian doctrine is not easy to understand, but the Christian must be able to give a reason for the hope in Jesus. There is little used to exhorting people to be Christians if they don't know why being a Christian is so. It's not enough to present the Christian message as something to be studied and understood. It must be presented as something to be done. I stop by to tell you you ought to be an example. And Paul said that what we all will do is give yourself your attention to the public reading and the exhortation of the word. And I stop by to tell you that the example that Christian leaders set then went further in their lives or the ministry should be dynamic and progressive. People should be able to observe what they are and what they are becoming, supplying evidence that they are growing into mature Christians. And some Christian people imagine that they appear to be perfect with no physical flaws, blemishes, or stains. But there are two reasons why this is a mistake. First, it is hypocritical. Since none of us have all the virtues, it is dishonest to pretend to be so perfect in front of our young people. And secondly, to pretend it discourages those who may give their life to Christ. Was a witness to this, for he conceives that he had not arrived. For he says, not that I have already obtained all of this, or already have been made perfect. But one thing I do, I forget those things that I behind, and I press on toward the mark. All I'm trying to tell you is be an example by the example you lead. Be an example by being committed. Well, I'm gonna lead you, and I tell you that you ought to be an example, because somebody is counting on you, and it's right there in the text. Verse 16 says, pay close attention to your life, your teacher, and persevere in these things. By doing so, you will save both yourself and your hills. And I find that problematic, because Paul wasn't saved that Timothy could save himself. None of us can. We don't have heaven or hell to put ourselves in. But what Paul is saying, if you guard your life and guard your heart, follow Jesus, trust and obey. Tell somebody that there is a way out of no way. And Paul, what we got here, what is just written in detail? Watch your life and doctor close that. In other words, Jimmy didn't have control over nobody but himself, but he had to work himself well. Aren't you glad that my ability to lead and influence others is connected to my ability to manage and live well? And that's the good news of the Jacob, that I know the life needs can be the catalyst by which someone else might be saved. And I wonder who you are. Are you here? Will you accept the clarion call to be an example? I'm so glad that God left on record an example to follow. We ought to follow the example of the one who knew no sin. We ought to follow the one who came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. We ought to follow Jesus, the leader of the Bible, the Bible of God. We ought to follow him through a hill called Calvary. They walked him high, stretched him wide. Blood and water came from his side. He died. Do you know he died? But I'm so bad. That's not how.
The story is, 3 days later, he rose again with all power in his hands. And God is calling us to be an example. Where are we to be an example today? We ought to be an example in our homes. We ought to be an example on our jobs. We ought to be examples with our friends, because it is by us that some of our friends will be saved. Doors of my Father's house stand open. Sister Hannah's coming with a presentation.
God bless you. God bless you. Lord. And I know it's nobody but the Spirit of God that has orchestrated today like he has with all the pink that I'm seeing throughout the sanctuary. I'm so grateful that God's reminding us that he will show us that we can endure and encounter anything. You see that I have just my phone in my hand. I'm going to let that rest because I really want this to be authentic. And from every song that was sang, every outpouring of the Spirit, God just fixed that thing. And when I think about survivors and warriors, they are examples. Nobody got to allow that message to come through today on Pink House Sunday so that we can see in the Word of God what it really looks like to trust God. I don't know because they haven't said that to me, but I know we have some people in the house who can raise your hand or take a stand. Matter of fact, stand because you're a warrior. You can use that as a tool.
Sure, we're going to be Dr. Hammer. Amen.
All right, guys.
I want to tell the church, thank you. Thank y'all for letting me do my ministry project here, because you didn't have to, because I got mad and said, now you need to do it somewhere else. But thank you all for your support over this 3-year journey. It has not been easy, but with your prayers, you are going to get to the end of this. Amen. 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 God, God's minds are clear. I'm going to go ahead and get a benediction. Listen, if you didn't get, I know they say it's singles. I know they say it's singles, but I'm a child at home. And if you are a senior and you didn't get any candy yesterday, please go to the fellowship hall. They have some stuff for you. Now, after the seniors have gone through, children, y'all follow back through, amen. I'm trying. I know they don't go home with me, so I'm trying, though. If our hearts and minds are clear, let us bow our head. She gonna pass it down. She gonna pass it. Yes, ma'am, they gonna pass it down. Amen. Amen. Let us bow. We ran out. We'll make some few more copies. If you didn't get one, we'll make some more copies. Let us bow our head. God, we come now to tell you thank you. Thank you for what our eyes have seen, our ears have heard, and our hearts have done. Lord, we ask that we would not only be hearers of your word, but that we would be doers of your word. We tell you thank you for what you're doing right here at the New Emmanuel. Thank you for allowing us to celebrate another Breast Cancer Awareness Month, oh Lord. Thank you for our survivors. Thank you for our warriors, our examples, oh Lord. Although they may not still be here with us, oh Lord, they showed us how to fight and serve you until the end. Yes. And for that, Lord, we tell you thank you, Lord. Now, Lord, as you dismiss us from this place, announce your sight, we ask that you would go with us, stand by us, leave us, God, keep us in your care. And if it's your will and you wake us tomorrow, we want to be better for you tomorrow than we've been for you thus far today. We've wronged anyone in word or in deed. We ask that you would forgive us, allow us to forgive ourselves. Give us strength, courage, and remembrance. Go back to all those we wronged and ask them forgiveness. And we ask that may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, so we can live in the Holy Spirit, rest with one another, with the ease of us here, forth and evermore. And the people of God said, amen. Amen.